This is the first video in a series on dynamic programming. It uses a classical example, calculating Fibonacci numbers, even though it might not technically qualify as dynamic programming when we finish with it. There aren't a whole lot of prerequisites, but you need to know recursion. So let's jump right into the problem. The Fibonacci sequence is defined recursively. The zeroth number is zero, the first number is one, and for all integers larger than one, it's the sum of the two previous numbers. Not surprisingly, with that definition, we can write a simple recursive program to calculate the ith Fibonacci number. And it works. But there's a problem. It's slow. Let's take a look at the recursion tree running on the number 8. If we make the call to the previous Fibonacci number first and put that into the left of our recursion tree, the left spine of the tree has length 7. Each time you have a second recursive call on the right, the value goes down by 2 instead of 1. The right spine will have length 4, but more generally, the right-hand spine has length about n over 2. So the top n over 2 levels of the tree are a full binary tree with 2 to the n over 2 nodes. That's exponential. But there's hope. You see those two subtrees rooted at 5 right in the middle of the tree? They're exactly the same, just repeating the same work. Not only that, but there's another 5 subtree all the way on the left. Every one of those subtrees computes the 5th Fibonacci number, and it's always 5. It's kind of dumb to repeat all of that work 3 times. The 4th subtree is smaller, but it gets repeated 5 times. So the big idea is to remember what values you have recursively computed so that you don't repeat any work. I'll add a dummy wrapper that allocates a table to hold all the values and then just slightly change the main program to check the table for an answer before making any recursive calls and to save the answer before returning it. We could have kept the same base case, but I put it into the table instead. Let's see what that does. The recursion tree starts filling in the same as before, and within the table, those calls start on the right-hand side. Smaller and smaller values are called, and once you get down to the base cases, the table starts filling in from the left in order. In the tree, the left spine of the problem looks exactly the same as before, and each of those first time calls you make to compute the ith value has a subtree. But once you leave that spine, the second time you try to compute the ith value, you just look up the answer without any recursive calls, pruning that subtree down to just a leaf. That's the main idea behind dynamic programming. It's not programming by James Bond. It gets its name from dynamic memory allocation used to store the recursive subproblem answers. Sexy. The table's like a well-organized bunch of post-it notes, or memos, and this method is called memoization. Not memorization, memoization. It allows you to keep the same natural recursive structure in your code, but it keeps you from recomputing values. It's worth looking at a very slightly different version of the program with just a switch in the order of our recursive calls. What happens to the recursion tree? Well, for the unmemoized version, it looks the same as before, except the long spine is on the right. But for the memoized version, the tree will look different. In the table, we see recursive calls skipping every other value, and then calling those values as you start to fill in lower values. But even though recursive calls are made in different orders, the table gets filled in just the same as before, from the left to the right, one at a time. We ended up with a tree that's only half as deep, but twice as wide. It has exactly the same number of nodes as the first version did, but they're arranged differently. Just due to the layout, we can call that version with a larger value and still see what's going on. I especially want to focus on the fact that the table gets filled in exactly the same order as before, perfectly from left to right. Why is that? Well, let's focus on one arbitrary value from that table, somewhere in the middle. Let's say the ninth one. The ninth Fibonacci number depends on the seventh and eighth Fibonacci numbers. So the program needs to finish computing them before it can compute the ninth one, no matter what order the recursive calls are made. We can imagine that completing each of those recursive calls is a prerequisite for this one to happen. And if we want to, we can set that up for the whole graph. Here, each subproblem gets pointed to by its prerequisites. This gives us a way to get rid of the recursion. We can just fill in the table in an order that finishes prerequisites for any node before getting to that node. Here, because it's just a one-dimensional array and each value needs the one to its left to be finished before it, there's only one way to fill in the table, left to right. But more complex problems will have multi-dimensional tables with more choices. Once we know what order the table needs to be filled in, we can just fill it in that order. This gives us the iterated, bottom-up version of the program instead of the memoized, recursive, top-down version. Here, we use a simple loop through one index to fill the table. Filling in each space takes constant time, so it takes total linear time. So if this takes linear time, the same as the memoized version, why bother? First of all, it is quicker. It replaces the overhead of recursive calls with a simple loop. More importantly, it lets us look at the table more carefully to see if we need the whole table. When we filled in the ninth value here, we used the seventh and eighth values, but after that, we never looked at the seventh value again, or any value below the seventh value. We went from one extreme of not remembering anything to the other of remembering everything forever. It's okay to forget stuff you won't need anymore. So we could just store a table with three values and calculate all of our answers like before, but use our indices modulus 3. Or if we want to just overwrite a value once we use it, just use indices mod 2. This lets us save a smaller table, so we only take constant space instead of linear space. So here, we only need a fixed extra amount of space. So in some technical sense, we've optimized the dynamic right out of the problem. But this simple problem still shows the standard steps of dynamic programming. The first step is to get a recursive solution to your problem, which is usually the hardest step, but was trivial here. After that, you look at the subproblem parameters to figure out how many there are and see if you can save subproblem solutions. And if you can, you can write a memoized solution. Figuring out what order the table gets filled in, you can make an iterative version. Then you can sometimes optimize over space. I've ignored complicating issues about large Fibonacci numbers, like the fact that they grow exponentially. And this isn't the fastest way to compute them anyway, but it's a simple example to set up these steps for dynamic programming. Sometimes there's an extra step at the end, especially for optimization problems. We didn't see that one here. We will see each step fleshed out more in the next upcoming videos, but for now, I've got to work on my ASMR video.